Welcome to According to John, where the answers come first and the explanations later. Kind of like how all YouTube videos should be. Today we're looking at Lenovo's P52 mobile workstation. The good. Very durable, solid chassis. You will not be disappointed by the build quality of this machine. Quadro graphics, high-end Quadro graphics, up to 128 gigabytes of RAM if you need it, and up to three internal storage devices and a marvelous keyboard. The bad, thermals. Thermals suck. And I don't know if it's just my copy. I hope it is, but we'll get into that a little bit later and I'll show you some temperature charts while we're stress testing and they're not pretty. The 4K display is practically unusable outside. Not that it's not a great panel, color accurate, very vivid, very sharp, but the 4K display comes with this piece of glass that is very, very reflective. And outside, it's practically unusable. Even if you're in a coffee shop and you have a bright light on your skin, that will reflect off the screen and lowers the visible contrast. So it's not that great. So definitely get the 1080p matte option if you need to use this in a bright environment. And the speakers aren't that great, but you're not buying this type of computer for great speakers. Like its predecessor, the P51, this P52 is Lenovo's premier 15-inch mobile workstation. You can get it with up to an i7-8850H or a Xeon 2176M processor, up to 128 gigabytes of DDR4 RAM, up to a Quadro P3200, a MaxQ version graphics card, and up to three internal storage devices, two M.2 and 1 2.5-inch bay, and up to a 4K screen. They also have a 1080 option, like I mentioned before, 1080p option with a matte screen. The version we have here is the i7-8850H with the P3200 graphics, 4K screen, 32 gigs of RAM, and an aftermarket 850 Pro 2.5-inch SSD and a Western Digital Black NVMe drive, M.2. Yeah. Taking a closer look at the chassis, the left side greets us with an exhaust port, USB-A 3.1 port, SD card reader, and optional smart card reader. The rear offers us two exhaust ports, power connector, two USB 3.1 Type-C Thunderbolt 3 ports, HDMI 2.0, and gigabit Ethernet. The right side presents us with a Kensington lock port, exhaust port, mini display port, two USB-A 3.1 ports, and a headphone mic jack. Taking a look at the keyboard, you'll notice that it looks a lot like the T580, and that's because it's the same keyboard. Backspace, backward slash, enter, and shift all have been slightly shrunk, but I haven't noticed any difference in typing on it versus the old version. The feel and lovely typing experience has made it into this iteration. The trackpad is no longer a Synaptics model, but from a company called Elan. It's okay, precise, and feels smooth. Trackpad buttons feel okay. I wish they would have a little bit more tactility to them, especially the ones for the track point. It's a very delicate click, very soft, but it is still there and it'll register throughout the entire button. So I guess that's okay. Keyboard flex is minimal to non-existent. You'll notice no more Pantone color calibrator, and that's not necessarily a bad thing, as if you're doing color critical work, you're most likely going to get a more expensive color calibrator for your display anyways. Fingerprint reader, though, is still there. You can either get a 1080p matte screen display or this 4K multi-touch, which glares up the wazoo. It's almost unusable outside, like I said before, or near any windows, so choose very wisely. But colors are very accurate, very vivid, and everything is very crisp and sharp. The claimed 400 nit brightness, though, is a bit high. I measured only about 316. All right, so let's answer this question one more time. Does it thermal throttle? Yes. I suspect something might be itchy with my model because it does idle around 65C at 0% CPU utilization at 1.8 gigahertz. So something doesn't seem right here. And when you hit it with a load such as Cinebench, it instantly goes to 99C and thermal throttles. But a little bit more on that later when we get to benchmarks, which is right now. Let's hit it. Looking at Cinebench, we start out at a respectable 1183, but hitting it again yields slightly lower at 1092, and consecutive runs level us out at about 1099. looking at the thermals, we see that we peg our temps right at 99°C and start thermal throttling around 3.5 gigahertz. After a while, thermal limit throttling kicks in and keeps us around 3.1 gigahertz, yielding our scores around 1088. If we simply uninstall the Microsoft Dynamic Throttling Framework, we can prevent this from happening and keep the chip running at about 45 watts, but at about 97°C and 4 gigahertz. Nice trade-off for speed, but 97°C is hot. You can hear the fans spin up, but they aren't annoying in pitch or volume. But if you're like me, I like the sound of a computer just working hard. Running the Passmark suite yields very strong numbers, with our i7-8850H processor just shy of 14700 points. The Quadro P3200 graphics 2D score is about 836, 3D graphics at 9501, memory mark at 3146. Disk results are kind of mute since I have aftermarket parts in it. The underside is where you can access all of the upgradable components. You'll find the 90 watt hour battery here, 77++ for your reference. By removing these screws, you can access two NVMe M.2 slots and a 2.5-inch SATA drive bay, two memory slots with two more under the keyboard, along with the wireless card and LTE card if you choose that option. The SIM slot is located in the battery compartment. So overall, a very solid performer from Lenovo, and something that's quite on par with what HP and Dell have to offer, while being a little bit more affordable, actually by a couple hundred dollars. Great keyboard, solid chassis, thermals, could use a little bit of TLC. I might have to send this in and see if it's something with my unit specifically. If that is the case, I will create some new content with new thermal testing on this. But thanks for stopping in today. Hit that like button if you like buttered toast, and we'll see you next time.